For effective learning, sometimes we need to think exactly opposite, out of the box. This helps in many ways, like learning from the mistakes, avoiding the pitfalls. After all, come what may, like driving a car, the control on the brake is important than that on the accelerator. We are all pretty aware that the skills of the marathoner and sprinter are entirely different. An expert sprinter is likely to fare poorly in a marathon race, and so is the vice versa. You must say that it is just a common sense. Using the same analogy, let us walk through the choice of steroids, cycloplegics in UVITs. Long-acting UVITs needs long-acting steroids, and inappropriate short-acting steroids with lesser dosing intervals will undoubtedly act as a stimulus for reactivation. The golden concept in UVITs treatment is that topical steroids will not reach effective concentration for inflammation beyond anti-inflammatory phase. Logically, for vitritis, posterior pole diseases, topical steroids in solo cannot be used for titrating active inflammation. In UVITs treatment, before pressing the start button with intraocular or periocular steroids, beware of the infectious etiology like ARN, toxoplasmosis, for they are the absolute contraindications of the procedures, and ignoring them can lead to nothing short of catastrophe. Lateral thinking in UVITs pays rich dividends. The fact that you have differentials does not mean that you are unsure of the diagnosis. Mistreating acute retinal necrosis as besets UVITs with all powerful immunosuppressants, biologicals, may make you cut a really sorry face. Both are very close differentials with no single lab test that will prove either of them. As to your clinical correlation, is a felt need to delineate them. In fact, robots are poor substitutes for excellent clinicians. Most clinicians believe in undertreating UVITs severely with needed anti-inflammatory stuff, being steroids or immunosuppressants or planning surgery. What is needed is optimal titration. Ripley, believe it or not, the dose tolerability of methotrexate in children is higher than for adults. Not treating UVITs if vision is good and as a sole parameter is a bad clinical judgment. You can have a lot of problem, be it CME, CNVM, glaucoma, neovascularization, cataract, active UVITs, etc., even with vision of 6/6. It is a matter of time, the vision will drop drastically if not adequately treated at the correct time. Procrastination of the definitive treatment plan in lens-induced UVITs, that is, cataract surgery, is a futile exercise. When sure of the definitive treatment plan, better to shoot the target first. Be crystal clear that you need to treat the patients and never the lab results alone implies use clinical correlation of the lab reports, be it Mantoux test, QuantiFERON, PCR test and histopathology reports and whatnot. Because any lab test has its own false positivity and negativity. Never hesitate to reconsider the investigation. There is a saying in MR, repeat and repeat. It yields a lot of newer investigatory behaviors because the diseases are in the different stages of evolution. Recently, with the advent of anti-VEGFs, people have started developing affinity and philiac attitude to use Avastin for all the UVIT conditions, come what may. But beware, in active UVITs, anti-VEGFs are a contraindication. Steroid cover is not equal to steroid bombardment, the commonest ever in UVITs. Please understand, gradual tapering of steroids is a treatment of recurrent UVITs. Put it ulta, sudden weaning of steroids is a discrete stimuli for reactivation of UVITs. This was well established in the British Journal of Ophthalmology 2004 under the article Steroid Prophylaxis in Eyes with Uveitis Undergoing PHACO, where they compared with two groups, one with steroid bombardment of IVMP versus gradual tapering of oral steroids. It proved the IVMP group had increased inflammation due to increased breakdown of the blood aqueous barrier. Specific treatment of uveitis matters a lot when handling the sequelae like CMV, CNVM, cataract, etc. Not giving the specific anti-infective treatment along with the intended treatment of sequelae like giving IVTF or CNVM can cause reactivation of inflammation. So does the inflammation reactivate in case of toxoplasma, ARN, Hansen's when handling the other sequelae. Fuchs uveitis is an uveitis of great difference. The vitritis of Fuchs does not merit treatment with periocular or oral steroids, but rather needs therapeutic vitrectomy. Topical steroids can actually increase inflammation in Fuchs uveitis. Of course, no posterior signing case means no use of cycloplegics. Uveitis plus glaucoma does not always mean that the problems in glaucoma are due to uveitis alone. Sometimes we need treatment of uveitis initiated if the inflammation is active and stop treatment of uveitis if the uveitis is inactive. So precisely delineating if the inflammation is active or inactive based on the intrinsic parameters of inflammation is very, very important. This subtle difference can make a lot of difference in focusing the aggressive treatment of uveitic glaucoma with needed anti-glaucoma maneuvers. Always understand that vision loss in uveitis can be multifactorial due to CNVM, CME, cyclic membrane, apart from cataract and glaucoma that we all always focus on. Not delineating the subtle CNVM can cause a lot of vision loss to our dear patients. Hope this video helps all of us to avoid them in our real-time practice.
Thanks a lot for your patient listening.